Everyone, I am Dr. Prashna Samata. In this present particular presentation, I am going to deal with the topic detailed concept of citizenship under Indian legislation. The prerequisites to understand this particular presentation as the Indian Constitution from Article 5 to 11, because they are the exclusive articles which deals with the concept of citizenship at the commencement of the Constitution basically. Then the entire legislation, that is the Citizenship Act 1955, deals with various aspects of citizenship and the related amendments which has happened in due time in the Citizenship Act also. They play a pivotal role in understanding the concept of citizenship. The main objectives with which the presentation deals is to understand the concept of citizenship under Indian Constitution, to understand various ways of acquiring citizenship under the Citizenship Act in India, and to understand the chief classification of citizenship which is being considered by Indian government. So the bold topics which I have covered in this particular presentation is the historical perspective of Indian Constitution in context of citizenship, provisions of Indian Constitution in terms of citizenship, various ways of acquiring citizenship in India, and chief classification of Indian citizens which has been admitted by Indian government. So Indians, those who were residing in India were no more British Indians, they were no more British subjects. So they have to be given with some citizenship, and India was having this duty to give citizenship, to confer citizenship to those peoples. Moreover, there is, because India faced partition at the time of its independence and been broken to two nations, Pakistan and India. So there were many people who had to relocate themselves either from Pakistan to India or India to Pakistan. But we are concerned because we are dealing with Indian Citizenship Act or Indian Constitution. So those people who crossed the territory of Pakistan and relocated to India, they also were needed to confer Indian citizenship. So India, because at that time India was a nascent state, it just came into existence and it was not having any legislation regarding the citizenship policies. So in absence of any such legislation, Indian Constitution had to have certain clauses by virtue of which Indians will be given citizenship. So that is why chapter 2, that is a citizenship chapter, was introduced in Indian Constitution, and that is how Article 5 to 11 are those set of articles by virtue of which Indians were given citizenship at the commencement of the Indian Constitution. Now you can see that there were obviously many those who have particular interest in history of India, and they might be knowing that there were certain princely states who were there in India, and there were very interesting facts like annexation of Sikkim and regarding Nizam of Hyderabad, then Dadra Nagar Haveli, then Daman Diu. All of these basically they were having distinctive citizenship order initially, but later on once they became a part of India, part and parcel of India, they also got covered under Indian Constitution, the related clauses of Indian Constitution and Indian Citizenship Act 1955. Now, it is very interesting to say that the Indian Constitution provides single citizenship. It does not provide dual citizenship, in spite of the fact that India is having 25 plus states in its own territory, provinces in its own territory, but they have only one single citizenship, that is Indian citizenship. Okay, and there are various aspects or facets of Indian citizenship, like we can acquire, we can renunciate, we can terminate, one can get deprived of Indian citizenship under various circumstances. And as I have said previously also, that citizenship in India can be taken through four basic ways, that is by birth, by descent, by registration, and by naturalization. Now, apart from the basic Indian Constitution, the legislation which chiefly deals with citizenship is the Citizenship Act 1955. And in this particular Citizenship Act, the original Citizenship Act, later on many amendments have been done as per the requirements or the need of the time. That is Citizenship Act 1986, 1992, 2003, 2005, 2015, 2019. Now, this is the detailed process of acquiring citizenship. So, acquiring, as I have said, a person in India can acquire citizenship through birth, through descent, through registration, through naturalization. Now, there is a very thin line difference between registration and naturalization, and that is registration means if you have once renunciated or being deprived of Indian citizenship, and later on you want to reacquire that process is known as registration. And if you were never an Indian citizen beforehand and you just now want to become an Indian citizen, then the process which is being followed is the naturalization process. And the other ways in which the person can acquire citizen is by birth. But by birth, again, in case of by birth, Indian Constitution or Indian Citizenship Act follows a strict rule of jus sanguinis. That means till a certain point of time, it was jus soli. But looking into various infiltration, because India is a country where all of us know that a lot of population takes refuge from historical period till now, there has been constant inflow of people from the neighboring states. So looking into various factors and aspects and security issues, and there are many other plethora of aspects which are there. This absolute practice of jus soli was stopped years ago. And from then we started considering the fact of jus sanguinis. Then we have also citizenship by descent, that is by blood ties, which I have said, even if the person is born outside India. Then if is desirous to have Indian citizenship, then how Indian Citizenship Act caters them. So that is what has been basically covered in these particular clauses. This can be read and it can be understood. There are many years and cutoff dates which has been provided, but these cutoff dates, every cutoff dates have their own significance. Looking into the contextuality of that cutoff date, every cutoff date has their own contextuality. None of the cutoff dates have been given just for the fact of giving it. Now, citizenship of naturalization, as I have said, is obviously there. Citizenship of India by naturalization can be acquired by a foreigner, obviously not an illegal migrant, who is ordinarily resident in India for 12 years and other qualification as specified in the third schedule of Indian Citizenship Act. So there are various other compliances which a person has to need to naturalize to Indian citizen, being an Indian citizen. Now, as I have said in my previous slide, that there are classification of citizenships. Now, there are citizens who are originally citizens in India, who have taken birth in India, who are growing in India, or in the wake of taking better life or having a better life have moved out of India, but they somehow, because their kids now are desirous to continue with Indian citizenship, they apply for Indian citizenship through registration, or they can also adopt Indian citizenship through their descent. But apart from that, there's something called OCI, Overseas Citizenship of India. Now, it's a very interesting concept that what is OCI? OCI means that suppose someone is not staying in India for a long time. They have moved from India like 50 years ago or something like that, and they are settled somewhere else in a foreign land. But due to some issue, due to some business connection or family connection or something like that, they have to constantly come to and fro, make a frequent move to India. So, if a person has to make a frequent move to India, every time clearing the migration, every time applying for visa, every time renewing the passport, of course, renewing passport is there, but applying from visa, then clearing the visa becomes an arduous task for the individual also and for the office concerned also. So, what has been found out by Indian government that for those people who very frequently makes a visit to India, they can be given a status. And that status can be enjoyed by them in certain set of rights. Not all the rights can be conferred to them. Like there are some rights like right to vote. Right to vote is not available to overseas citizenship of India. They cannot vote for Indian elections. Neither they can stand in elections. So there are certain set of rights which cannot be conferred to them, because obviously they are enjoying the citizenship right of some other country, and India as a country does not believes on dual citizenship. So obviously we will make a mistake if we understand overseas citizenship of India as a concept of dual citizenship. This is absolutely not dual citizenship. Dual citizenship means full-fledged citizenship rights. But overseas citizenship of India is not a dual citizenship. It is a special privilege which is given to a certain set of people who make a frequent visit to India, so that they don't also follow prop. They don't also face problem while moving, while making so frequent to and fro movement to clear migration every time and to go through such cumbersome procedures over and over again. So because of that, it is that this OCI card is given to people, so that if you show OCI card, you will be considered that yes, you are some person who is, of course, your objectives or your motto to come to India has to be disclosed properly. But if you have an OCI card, there are various array of rights which are available to such people, but and not to the foreigners or not to the occasional visitors to India. So for that purpose, OCI card status has been given. Now there is some called something called PIO also, Person of Indian Origin Card. However, in the post 2015 amendments, this OCI and PIO card has been coagulated. But until 2015, it has been made singly as OCI card. But until 2015, the PIO, Person of Indian Origin Card, was very much into practice. So we should also understand what was that concept, because that also plays a pivotal role in the concept of citizenship rights and immigration in India, basically. So Person of PIO means there's some identification issued to an individual who held a passport in a country other than Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, Nepal, Pakistan and Sri Lanka, and could prove that they're Indian origin up to three generations before. So there are certain, like as I said, that there are certain people who are desirous of holding Indian citizenship, so they can acquire it through descent. But if they are residing in those countries except Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, Nepal, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, they can do so by showing that their three generations before, like their great-great grandfather or grandmother was an Indian by birth or by descent. So by that way, they can also, they have a way to get the citizenship through descent. So that how it will be established. So for establishing such connection, PIO card used to be given. But not to those people who used to reside in these countries, which has been named here. Basically, the South Asian states who are the direct neighbors of India and China also. So, but now, as I have said, PIO concept is no more into existence. This is just OCI, which is came into comes into practice, and OCI card is given to all of those people. And these exception countries has also not been considered as exception in this particular categorization. Now, at the end of this particular presentation, there are again some practice questions. Now, what is Indian citizenship under Indian constitution? What is Indian citizenship under various legislations, specifically Indian Citizenship Act? What are the various ways of acquiring citizenship, and what are the chief classification of Indian citizenship do we have? So these are some of the questions which we can practice, and if we practice all of these questions, I hope the entire presentation becomes very fruitful for those who are listening to this particular presentation. Thanks a lot for a patient hearing. Hope to see you again in some of my other presentations. Thank you so much.